YouTube Nation, Manvin TV, aka MeTV, aka let me find out that the Lingerie League is hitting harder than the NFL. Matter of fact, it's already hitting harder than the EPL. We're going to talk about this today, all right? Super Bowl, that's right. We're going to talk about the Super Bowl. I want to say congratulations to the Giants fans. You guys have been through hell. I understand that you're happy and you're still celebrating. Go ahead and celebrate. I hope that they showed us a parade here so I can see at least my friends have some fun. All right. Like I said, my family and friends in New York. However, Boston fans, I know how you feel. Those guys in the fourth quarter should have caught that ball. I'm not trying to hear Russ Welker is getting a free pass on this. All right. Tom Brady, yeah, the pass was a little off, but it hit Welker in both hands. All right. But I want to say, Boston, I know you're feeling bad right now. And I said I'd show you some love today. So, yeah, I'm showing y'all some love. My friends gonna get kicked out of this. I'm telling you out there, but it's okay. Boston fans, you had a good run. You shouldn't feel bad. I will say right now, though, that all those jokes about Spygate is going on, and Howard Eskin has come out and said that the NFL has documented that the Patriots did cheat throughout those other Super Bowls. That's right. However, I want to see the documents myself first before just coming out and doing it. You know what I mean? I want to see it. I want to see the proof. Since he said there's, now that the NFL has documented it. Now, I want to talk about the Super Bowl. Let's get into this, man. Because, first off, I want to say I'm very disappointed in sports fans due to the fact that as the Super Bowl was going on, soccer fans or football fans, wherever you're from, all right, soccer fans were bagging on the Super Bowl, which makes no sense. And it wasn't just the fans. No. All right, it was the players as well. Because anyone saw my Twitter feed, me and Wayne Rooney were going at it. All right, he's coming out. He first comes out. This is boring. This is stupid. They call this football. This isn't football. And he's just going off. And I'm like, yo, if you don't like the game, don't watch it. No one's got a gun to your head, Wayne Rooney. You understand that? And he's still going on. This sucks. Look, you are a professional football player, all right? Soccer player, whatever. You are a professional. You do not go around bagging other sports. You have to understand, especially on their biggest stage. How would you like it if you were on, if you're at your championship, and all of a sudden, all these American football players came out and said, you suck. Your sport sucks. You would have a fit. You guys would have a, you would have a riot, all right? And we're not even talking about the riots that's going on, you know, that political riot that would have happened in Egypt on a soccer field, because that's what it was more of. The news here tried to say it was just over a soccer game. No, that, I understand there were rivals, but it was more than that. And you guys let me know that as well, because that's all we saw here, all right? But you guys got back to me on that. Like I said, there is no reason for a professional football player to bag on other football players. And then the fans got into it. And then other fans, American football fans and soccer fans, they were just fighting with each other, and they're calling soccer players kickball players. And I'm talking to Wayne Rooney. Look, you cannot sit here and say that these guys don't have any heart when soccer players are notorious for flopping and faking injuries. You can't say that, but it happens also in every sport. We also know this, but soccer is very much known for it, just like basketball, very much known for flopping. But where do you think they got it from? From soccer. It's ridiculous. So I'm not trying to hear you guys are the toughest, you know, in the world, all right? You guys play a great sport. Why is it that you just can't love both sports? Why? Why can't I love American football and soccer? Why can't I do that, huh? I don't understand that. Why do I have to pick? I shouldn't have to pick. This level of elitism has to stop. And Wayne Rooney was acting like an idiot that day. Rugby league's better than this and things. And he's just going on. And some of you guys are like, well, he's right. It is better. Look. That's an opinion. But you have to understand that Wayne Rooney should not be coming out and saying these type of things during the Super Bowl. It's stupid. There's a reason why these guys wear pads. The last I checked, I haven't seen any soccer players as of late, you know, get hit so hard that, you know, they have concussions. I won't even say concussions, because some of them have fake concussions before, and I showed you that on the show, all right? But no. I'm talking spinal injuries, guys who can't play anymore. There's a reason why they wear pads, all right? And like some of you guys said on Twitter, if you put a soccer player next to an American football player and you had them play, someone's bringing body bags, because that soccer player's going to get destroyed. All right? Don't give me this. There is a reason why they are so physical. You're not going to bag on our sport. Well, I'm not bagging on your sport. I love your sport. But don't come in my zone as well, you know, and all of a sudden want to destroy American football. The game was great. For him to complain so much, the game was great. And people are like, this is boring. I would rather see a defensive game than a blowout. You know how many Super Bowls there's been blowouts and people are like, yeah, they're not coming back from this. And people turn the channel or walk away. You want to keep people at least watching TV. And he's like, I can't wait till Madonna comes. I can't wait for the music. So you're watching a Super Bowl for Madonna? Really? See, now I'm suspecting you. I really am. Because the Super Bowl halftime show was a joke. And I'm not trying to hear this. The halftime show was a joke. You got all these clowns on TV that nobody cares about. Who's who's, you know, talking, I mean, singing with Madonna and rapping with Madonna and everything, nobody cares, all right? Half you guys were like, who's this? Who's that? Yeah, it doesn't matter. And then people look. Then people get mad because MIA comes out and flips off the middle finger. And now all of a sudden, the Parents Association is mad. Let's get something straight here, all right? That commercial they showed, and the commercials were horrible too, but the commercial they showed, the one commercial they showed, the one girl was bringing out so much sex appeal towards this one guy that she took the foam off his latte and it hit it in the titties and it was running down and all the sexual innuendo. And Brian Dawkins came out and said, you know, they really need to put a parental guidance, you know, warning before showing the commercials. They really do, because that's how sexual it was. So the Parents Association doesn't have a problem with that commercial, but you have a problem with MIA flipping the finger. Really? Is this what we've come to today? Seriously, I mean, it's bad enough that you went off and got mad at Janet Jackson for showing, which was a wardrobe malfunction, for 2 seconds, maybe? 2 seconds. You didn't even see it. You had to slow it down to see the damn thing. But whatever. That's complainers for you. There's always going to be someone watching and complaining. Always, all right? And like I said, the commercials were horrible. I think I saw like 3 commercials that were funny, all right? The commercials were, and thing is, these days, they've become so predictable. Let's see. Babies, check. Animals, check. The polar bears, check. GoDaddy.com, check. I don't understand this. Then you got Clint Eastwood coming out here and, oh, well, you should know that the American people and jobs. And shut up. Shut up. And like a lot of you guys said online, it's funny because when you sit on Twitter, you know, no one jumped at you. But when I say it, here comes the cavalry, apparently. Clint Eastwood, you are a rich actor and you're complaining about there's no jobs and things of this nature. And you're trying to give this long-winded speech, right? But here's the thing. You're not helping create jobs. You're not. But you're talking. You got paid for that, didn't you? I'm not trying to hear it. Unless you're going to offer a solution to problems, then guess what? Shut up. As far as I'm concerned. And then right afterwards, after Clint Eastwood had that long-winded speech, and some of you said that you were getting ready to cry over it, which you gotta be kidding me, all right? But I'll put it like this. Right after that, the NFL showed a 15-second spot of, we giving away $1 million. So he's complaining about jobs while the NFL's trying to give away $1 million. Like, you have to understand they do these things to get you. And what happened at the end of the Clint Eastwood one? What happened? Dodge symbol came up. Because he's trying to sell you cars. That's why. It's a joke. Like I said, you got to look past all those things and understand it is an advertisement. They're using certain things to pull at your heartstrings and hopefully that you would buy a car. That's what it was. And we all know car commercials and beer commercials are going to happen, Doritos and stuff like that, because that happens all the time when you watch regular American football. So that's not a big deal. The commercials were a joke. Best commercial of the night? I'm sorry. But when you put He-Man on screen with Fat Albert and you got Voltron in the background, yeah, that's a win. That's a win. That's an automatic win. The M&M's commercial was pretty funny. The Cheetah commercial was really funny, I thought, when he was supposed to race the car. And the guy let him out the cage and he stopped and let the car go and turned around and went after the guy. I thought that was pretty funny. Everything else was stupid. The dog bribing the dude with Doritos. Yeah, that was stupid. The baby slingshot and the baby. I'm surprised people didn't have a problem with that, with the slingshot, you know, but that was stupid. It I don't know. The only thing we didn't see was it the E-Trades baby, which was fine, but you had your fair share of babies anyway. It was, like I said, the commercials were a letdown, and I had said they need to just go back to what we all knew, because we saw so many Budweiser commercials, as usual, but bring back the Bud Bowl. Bring them back for halftime, so we don't have to see this long entertainment show. That's not what the Super Bowl was about. It really wasn't. And when you have all these fake fans, it's a joke. We saw this, the Pro Bowl, how they bring out all those stage fans to come out and cheer and carrying on, and no one knows them. They don't care. They know their stage. What was it? One guy online came out and admitted that they were stage fans, that he got paid for that. So like I said, they're actors. They're plants. That's what they call them. They're plants. That's all it is. Guys, understand it's all a big production. And like I said, if you've watched football from even the 90s, you'd know it wasn't that big of a production. Madonna pretty much stepped into the 300 and came out, and, you know, she had her little extravagant thing. That's fine. She almost fell on stage. That's fine, too. It doesn't bother me. We all knew she was going to lip sync because, come on, she's old. She's old. But she looks great for her age. I'm not going to bag on her. She looks great for her age. I mean, come on. But the whole world peace thing at the end really bothered me, because I put it like this. You're watching a game where guys are ripping each other's heads off and you're talking world peace. The same thing with soccer, as we have to keep hearing, you know, stop the race hate. Did you not see what happened? You know, I'm going to put the link in the info bar for you guys. For those who don't know, Chelsea, John Terry was stripped of his captaincy, England captaincy, because of the fact that he is involved in some type of race incident right now. That's right. Now, look, being a man of color, all right, you have to understand these things are not cool. They're not, like I said, there's no room for racism. I've done a video about this 2 years ago about athletes and race. There's no room for it. I understand you're going to strip him because it's still a trial going on. You don't know what's going on yet. But I put it like this. If he's found guilty, then guess what? He should be kicked out the league. All right, and this is the thing. If they don't, if he's found guilty and they don't kick him out the league, that sends the wrong message. The same thing with the NHL. When that guy was throwing bananas, it sent the wrong message because they didn't, you know, how can I put this, ban him from the actual league to come see the games. Same thing with players. Players have to respect each other. All right, you don't go that far. You just don't. But that's a problem, and we've seen it time and time again in soccer. And like I said, they have the banners up saying, you know, stop the hate. And we've seen this all the time before the game starts where they get in lines and they start, you know, and shake each other's hands and everything. It has to stop. But you know what, Eagles fans? I know you feel bad. I know Steve Smith feels bad right now. He's still crying somewhere, you know, for leaving the Giants. But I mean, I play like this. Eagles fans, Giants players and Patriots players actually had some words to say to you guys before the Super Bowl.
So, we went around and asked the Giants and Patriot players, are Eagle fans really the roughest and toughest fans in the NFL?
Don't they have a courthouse in their stadium or something? So, anytime you meet that in between, you should be playing better at the top.
What's the worst thing you've heard from an Eagle fan or Eagles fans?
I don't think I can say it.
Are they the meanest, toughest fans in the NFL that you see?
He's from, that's my favorite movie. I love you guys.
That's Giants punter Steve Weatherford. I think he's being a little sarcastic. He did apologize for calling Philly a dump.
So Philly fans, now I have to ask you, how do you feel about that? Because Giants and Patriots players are giving you your credit and saying you're a tough crowd, all right? That's what they're doing. And yeah, Weatherford was being sarcastic. He's still a little bitch as far as I'm concerned. I will never forgive him for what he said. But these people out here struggling that you don't know, that are out here struggling day in and day out, there's people being killed. Right now we have the highest murder rate, people. All right, people being killed for no reason. All right, you want to sit here and say this city is a dump? No, when people are trying to survive, you don't even know them. You don't see me going to New York and saying, all you Giants fans, all this city sucks. No, you don't see me doing that because it's not true. It's not. Even Giants fans were mad at Weatherford when it happened. Even in the Super Bowl, when he's jumping around before they won, Giants fans were like, yo, why is he jumping around? The punter's the last person to be jumping around like that. Exactly. Because no one respects the punter. That's what it comes down to, because you're not out there the whole time, but yet you're the first person to run your mouth. You're a joke, and I will never forgive you for that. And like I said, I don't care if you like Rocky or not. Like I said, you're just being sarcastic anyway at this point. All right, but Philly fans, I need to move on. Oh, before I move on, Boston fans, I pull like this. You tell Tom Brady's wife to shut her mouth. Shut her mouth. All right, I understand you don't throw receivers under the bus. Yeah, they didn't catch those passes. They didn't. All right, but there's no way she should be coming out and getting mad because Giants fans are heckling her. Look, if you can't take the heckling, because that's part of the game, that's part of being a fan, all right? If your team loses, someone's going to make fun of you. If you can't take that, then you don't need to be at the games, as far as I'm concerned. And it was already bad enough that you tried to send that email out, whoever, you know, leaked that email, saying, please pray for Tom Brady and my husband because we want him to win so bad. Yeah, because no one else wants to win that bad either, huh, Giselle? This is what happens when supermodels try to get angry and look like idiots. That's what happens, all right? We see all this with Naomi Campbell, did we not? Idiot. Complete diva, complete idiot. This is what they do. Stay in your lane. Go get, look sexy and go take some pictures. Leave the football to the rest of us. Seriously, I don't care if your husband's a football player or not. One of the best football players possibly ever, but like I said, leave it to the rest of us, please. Stay at home for now and watch the game if you can't take that type of criticism. I need to move on. All right, Philly fans, we need to talk. We know there's been some acquisitions to the team, and I know I've seen the, you know, people's comments and videos and here and there, and there's people who are for them and there's people who are against them. I know it's a slippery slope right now, and the media right now is trying to say, is this team better than last year's team and things of that nature. Roy Oswalt has moved on, thank God, because I put it like this. At the end of the season, he talked about while he was still under contract that he wanted to play for the Yankees. You are not going to say those type of things while you're here in Philadelphia. Did I not say when he came to Philadelphia in my video, did I not say when he first got here that it didn't look like he wanted to be here to begin with? All right, now he wanted to play for the Yankees. Now he may be playing for, what, the Cardinals or the Rangers or something? It doesn't matter at this point, all right? But I want to talk baseball for a minute because for those who don't know, the link I'll put in the info bar for you guys. The Washington Nationals, now we know they've picked up a lot of acquisitions from the Phillies, ex-Phillies. Now, as you know, for the previous couple of years, they've given Philly fans priority ticketing, right? Because Washington National fans didn't show up to the park. So when the Phillies came, it was pretty much like home for the Phillies. You had so many more Phillies fans than you had National fans. And Philly fans were willing to travel to go see the Phillies. So they would give us priority seating. Well, now they've cut that off. They're trying to actually ban Philly fans from coming into the park. They're cutting off priority seating to give it back to National fans. And they're running this campaign where it's take back the park. Now, mind you, this campaign, this is the second time they've tried this campaign, right? Because fans won't show up. It's really that simple. Now, I'm not saying all you National fans, all right? But this is something that's wrong. You relied on us to bring in and generate revenue for you guys. And now after all we've done for you, you're trying to cut us off. I understand that you want to give National fans some priority, but to try to make a campaign behind it is wrong. It's wrong. I understand you're trying to hype it up and sell it to people, but no, all right? So pretty much, if the Phillies compared to Phillies light, because you have Lidge now, I believe you just signed Durbin. I mean, you're getting pretty much all our X pieces. That's what you're doing. But I cannot wait for baseball season to start. Thank God football is over. I swear we need a break after all the drama that has happened. Need a break from it. We really do. But need to move on. Talk about Philadelphia Flyers real quick. Yeah. All right. Now look, we've been on a losing streak but we've just been dogging it out at this point, guys. I mean, I told you before, what did I say in the beginning of the season? Actually, in the offseason. If we don't beat the record that we had last year, all these moves are for nothing. And I understand that people are happy with the offense. I'm happy with the offense, too. These young guys, like I said, a lot of these young guys have stepped up. But what did I say? A lot of these young guys are going to go down to the Phantoms, too, right? And what have we seen? Phantoms, and they just keep bouncing back and forth. Flyers, Phantoms. Matt Walker, who we traded for Gagne. For those who don't know, Gagne last week, yeah, he had 8 points in one game. Yet ESPN didn't say anything about it. Not about it. They're not showing anybody love at this point when it comes to hockey. They're not showing anybody love when it comes to UFC. I mean, seriously, ESPN only has certain sports that they cover. Unless someone does something amazing. They didn't even acknowledge Gagne. It's pretty pathetic, all right? But we got Matt Walker for Gagne. Where's Matt Walker? Down there in the Phantoms. Because he's not ready. He can't play. Like I said, he's played more games this year than he did last year, but I mean, come on, you gotta be kidding me. This guy, we got him as an acquisition, and you tell me he's gonna stay all the way down to AHL for the rest of the season? And I understand, like I said, I understand people are happy about our offense. It's our defense, and it's our goaltending that's been a problem. But it's not just that, all right? Because I know a lot of people are just jumping on Breeze. It's become a running punchline at this point. Anytime somebody loses, Brizgalov is blamed. When the Patriots lost the Super Bowl, someone had tweeted, obviously, this is Brizgalov's fault, all right? It's a running gag at this point. But it's not just the goaltending or the defense, even though there are major factors. It's also the refereeing. How is that not tripping as far as I'm, you gotta be kidding me. But yet, it was okay. And in that game, the Flyers actually did force a comeback, but we still lost. See, this is the thing, all right? The Flyers, for some reason, they have serious lapses in defense. And I understand that they're missing Pronger, but you cannot rely on Pronger, all right? This guy is sitting at home right now depressed. He talk about retiring. All right, you cannot rely on him. You have to go out there and you have to play your game. Coach Love knows what needs to be done, but Coach Love also has a tendency of taking risks. And I understand he doesn't want to give up on any players, but Brizgalov has to sit down. Bob should be the starter regardless of his bad game over the weekend, all right? Bob deserved to be the starter. Brizgalov can only do but so much due to the fact that he still has problems with awareness and reflexes. He's not playing his angles right. He goes down too fast in the butterfly. I don't understand what he's seeing. I really don't. And a lot of you people on Twitter are upset about it because you're seeing the same thing I'm seeing. And you're saying, well, you know what? It's also a defensive problem. Look, I'll explain, all right? Because this was on CSN as well when I was watching TV. Because apparently when you have douchebags like Dave Murphy who covers this, covers the Phillies, but he doesn't know anything about hockey. And he's asking another guy on the show on TV, on live TV, well, how important is it for the D-man and the goalie to be in sync? How do you not notice? You're a sports writer. How do you not know this? All right, but it's very important. This is what happens when you have guys, like I've said before, this is what happens when you have guys who talk about sports but who've never played the sport, and that pisses me off, all right? The goalie and the D-man, they have to be pretty much synced to the hip. If a D-man, I'll play this, if there's a lapse in defense, all right, there's a defensive problem, it's the team's entire fault. However, the goalie is, like I've said before, the last line of defense. Now, if the goalie is straight up with another guy one-on-one and he gets beat, hey, it's his fault because he's not playing the angle right, he's not doing his job, he's not projecting where that puck is going. However, the D-man has to help him out. A good D-man, a good defensive back, defensive front, guess what? That will help your goalie out a lot. Your goalie could suck ass, and guess what? If you have good D guys, it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. You have to understand. I understand D guys. I have so much respect. You have to understand for D-men because they put their bodies on the line so much. And it's not like being a goalie, all right? When you're a goalie, you have all these pads and you can stop stuff, all right? But when you're a D-man and you have to lay down, there's a chance that that puck can hit you in the face or in the body and bumps and bruises and you can break something. That takes a lot of heart to do. This is why when I played goalie, I was always happy that I had good defenders around me because they made my job easier. They really did. Deflecting and stuff, it makes the job easier, it really does. Now, when you have guys who don't know what they're doing, they're playing out of position, like Braden Coburn, who got paid, $18 million this year, plays out of position all the damn time, yeah. And turnovers, yes, you're going to have a hell of a night. You are. You're in hell for that night. You better pretty much play on your head, all right? And the thing is, Brizgalov isn't built to play that way. He's not. He's not used to that. And like I said before, Brizgalov has better guys here in Philadelphia than he had in Phoenix, but he has to understand he does have to do his part. That's why he's getting a lot of junk from fans, because you actually upgraded your situation and you're still losing. That's the problem. That's the big problem. Like I said, defense and goaltending is a problem. Flyers, you have to pick it up. You were only 5 points behind from the Rangers, who beat us earlier. Well, let's just say last week. They beat us again. And the fans were chanting in New York, you can't beat us. Guys, you gotta beat the Rangers. We play the Rangers again this week. You gotta beat them at least once. All right? The Rangers pretty much have our number this year. And we'll give respect to the Rangers because we haven't beat them. We just haven't. All right? But seriously, Flyers, you have to step up. It's late in the season now. We're past the All-Star game. We're in the second half of the season. This is where you have to catch fire. This is where you have to dig in. This is where champions are made. You're going to have to go on a run. You're going to have to, especially going into the playoffs. If you make the playoffs. I think you will make the playoffs, but you have to dig deep. This is where it comes down to. Wayne Simmons, he's scoring all these goals all of a sudden, but we're still losing. I don't get it. Guys, you got to tighten up, really. And I know we play the Islanders tonight, so that'll be interesting to see. But it's been a bad week for Philly fans, I'll say, due to the fact that the Rangers beat us and the Giants won the Super Bowl. Like I said, congratulations, Giants fans. So, yeah. And like I said, I hope they show the parade. I really do. But I need to move on, guys. I want to talk about my Philadelphia 76ers. Now, guys, I've been kind of torn about this. I want to take it back from last week. Because last week, I gave you like 2 weeks worth of predictions, right? And we beat the Magic, like I said we could, if we played a certain way in play style. And we beat the Bulls, which I said we shouldn't beat the Bulls. But if you watch the game, the Bulls didn't really run with us. They really didn't. And it's not an excuse. And now we know that Derrick Rose is hurt. All right? We know that now. But that's not the point. We keep moving on. We played the Hawks. And I said that we could beat the Hawks. We played the Heat. And what did I say? We can't beat the Heat. And the thing is, on my Twitter page, y'all seen it. I go pretty much post for post. I do my own keys to the game, before the game starts, what we should do in order to win. Yesterday, before we played the Lakers, who I said we couldn't beat, all right? What did I say? Because I was out playing basketball, so I don't know what happened between on Twitter between then and now. I mean, then and before the game. When I got back from playing basketball, I said, in order to beat the Lakers, the Sixers will have to score points in the paint. I said, in order to have them a chance at rebounding, you'll have to start LaVoy Allen, and you'll have to start Spencer Hawes. You can't start anyone else, all right, when it comes, because you need size compared to Bynum and Soft Gasol. That's right. That's what I'm calling from now on. And what happened? They started LaVoy Allen. They started, Spencer Hawes? Like, and like I said, this is just me coming out from playing basketball. You got to think, these commentators, I had to turn the game off yesterday. I had to mute the game. I was watching the game, but I had it muted. Because I couldn't take the overhype, the exaggeration. Apparently, every bucket that we make wins the championship. That's how it feels right now. You have to be kidding me. Earlier, was it last week, Malik Rose comes out and says, Lou Williams got his third, you know, he dished off the ball to Thaddeus Young. He scored 3 points. Like, that's why Lou Williams has 3 assists, you know, a game. That's why he's the man. I'm like, 3 assists is nothing. 3 assists is nothing in this game. And you're going to try to hype that? See, it's things like that when you play these sports. I'm telling you. When fans get excited because they see a guy go around the back of the ball. Ooh, really? I see that at least 20 times a day when we out playing ball. What's the who factor for? This is the difference between players and people who don't watch the sport, play the sport. It's the difference, all right? But the Sixers did what they had to do last night. I had said, you got to go into the paint. You got to draw fouls. And I said, the size was going to be a big difference and that we need bigger guys. You have to go out there and get somebody. The Lakers doubled us in rebounds last night. That's right. Now, could you imagine? That's why Laker fans were mad last night, because they're like, we double you guys in rebounds, but you're still outscoring us. Like, what? And I understand. And you got Lou Will, who just catches fire. He earned his check last night, all right? God bless Lou Will. He earned his check last night. You know what I mean? He caught fire. He was clutch last night, and he beat the Lakers. He went out there and did what he had to do. Kobe was shooting shots from 25, 27 feet. He was making them in the beginning. But then at the end, he was jacking. And I said that. Didn't I say that online? I said, Kobe's going to get his, but he's going to take more shots than what he needs to. Half of those Lakers team, I didn't even know who the hell they were. I don't know. I'm like, who's that guy? What? But the thing is, Kobe doesn't. You can tell he doesn't trust his teammates. He doesn't. There was plenty of times guys was open like this. And he was like, double team, 25 feet out. I'm jacking because I'm Kobe. That's what it was. And that's what beat the Lakers, I feel. It wasn't that because the way we played, we scored consistently in the end. We won a 16-4 run, so I didn't have a problem with that, all right? And we did what we had to do. We dug deep, just like the Flyers need to do. But the Lakers just slowed up. They, like, just eased up on the throttle. Like, you actually had a chance at the end. Even Iguodala came out in the press conference last night and was like, he said, we thought we were going to lose that game in the end. But we dug, you know, we stuck in and we kept playing. The Lakers slacked off. That's what happened. And things, Laker fans, I'm going to get in this. Because as we were winning, there was like a minute left in the game. All of you are leaving the stadium. Why are you leaving? At that time, we were only up by 5. So why are you leaving the stadium with a minute left in the game? During the whole game, you saw guys holding up Kobe jersey. Yeah, we here. And you guys got up and walked out the stadium with a minute left. I'm not trying to hear you beating traffic, because you're not. Not with a minute left, you're not. All right, you better have left earlier than that. But the fact is, you can't do that. You have to stick by and see your team win or lose. You didn't pay all that money for tickets, all right? And speaking of tickets, I'll put it like this. Sixer fans, because we're going to talk about these bandwagoners today. That's right. For those who don't know, me and the CEO got into it because, yeah, and y'all know how I felt Monday. I was in a bad mood Monday, and this is when it happened last Monday, all right? Because he just put me over the top. So you guys know how I felt. And I was trying to talk to him about some serious issues just in the community, and he wasn't trying to hear that. He just wanted to keep selling things. Well, he pushed me to the limit.
You know my name, bitch. The streets gave me heat, and the eagle was the thing that they gave me. It's the rap gorilla that still clap, fucker.
Yeah, got you back,
Mac. Bitch, I move blocks and pounds. I move out with small blocks and towns. Move out with small blocks and pounds. Uh-huh. And I take everything to the table, bag and rock it down. Fuck you watching now. The neighbors, they in pocket now. Fuck you haters, cops in pocket now.
As far as I'm concerned, that's not a man, alright? The CEO, he's less than a man. He's a cockroach at this point. I do not respect him at all. You don't ever have to worry about me trying to do any type of other business with him. If I ever see him any other time, I will be cursing him out on camera. You have to understand, I am not afraid. You guys know this by now. I'm not afraid to speak my opinion, whether it's on here or out in the real world. That's what makes a man. And yes, there's going to be consequences to it, but guess what? That's what it takes. That's the decisions you make. That's what happens in life. But I want to move on because after talking, you know, to the CEO, we had also fake Philly fans, you know, the ones who have lived here for only a couple years and try to say that Philly isn't a basketball town. I wish that dude, well, you can tell he's never been to any other neighborhood than where he's at right now. I wish he would go down to one of these hoods, one of these parks, and tell these guys that this is Philly isn't built off basketball. Someone's going to punch you. That's what's going to happen, all right? People take basketball very seriously. You have to understand, all right? This place is built off basketball. Yes, in the pros, they are built off baseball. It's whoever is the biggest winner at the time, all right? That's what it really comes down to. We are now a big baseball town, and hockey has actually gotten to that level now as well, all right? It's getting some, you know, some praise. The Eagles haven't done anything, and the Sixers are on the rise because they've been losing for so long. But what you fail to realize is that basketball is always played. You can go somewhere every day, and there are going to be people running. That's what it comes down to. And if you lose, you might as well go home because guess what? There's seven other people on the side waiting to call the winners. Y'all know what I'm talking about, all right? I'm not trying to hear this. That dude obviously doesn't know what he's talking about. And you people on Twitter, y'all were laughing at him anyway, all right? But when I first saw that statement, I thought like throwing something. Like I said, because it's like, don't ever say that about Philly if you don't know Philly. Just because you live here a couple years doesn't mean you know everybody. You know the whole city. I'm not trying to hear that. All right, but I want to move on because I want to talk about a little bit more fakeness because I understand that people are happy about Andre Iguodala, but when this happened against Atlanta, I was pretty pissed off.
Implying that there is a 17-6 foul disparity between the teams. Implying that there is a 17-6 foul disparity.
Now let's get something straight here, people. Joe Johnson did not push him that hard. He's flopping for a foul, and you know how I feel about flopping. So anybody now that wants to say, you know, well, you know, Vent, all you do is jump on other teams, but you don't jump on your own teams. Here's a clear example of how I jump on my other teams, because it's a joke. And I understand that people are happy about, like I said, they're happy about, you know, Andre Iguodala. But this guy is averaging a little under 13 points a game, all right? For that contract that he has, for being his ninth season in the league, he's not going to get any better. And this is my problem. He said he is a highlight reel. Yes, he plays good defense, but not all the time. And he said last night, all he can do is probably limit players to their shots. That's all he can do, all right? Which to me doesn't say much. If anything, you go lockdown. That's what you do. You go lockdown. Now, for anyone who remember a couple years ago when he played against Kobe, he locked Kobe down. He locked him down. But we don't see that defense anymore. So for them to hype up this type of all-star defense, Olympic defense from Andre Iguodala, no, all right? Don't get it twisted. It's not that good, especially, like I said, and it's not just him. It's other people on the team like Meeks and everyone else. You can't play off a person 3-4 feet and let those shooters get that good look at that basket and shoot. We saw that in Miami, and I said this on Twitter. Go back and look at my Twitter feed, damn it. All right? I said this on Twitter. When we played Miami, I said, you cannot let Chalmers get good looks. And what happened in the first quarter? What happened? Two three-pointers, and then he was hitting a lot of mid-range shots. You have to D up. You got to get up on him, all right? I'm not trying to hear, oh, well, he'll blow by you. No, he won't. Not if you slide it correctly, all right? I'm not trying to hear it. If he puts the shoulder in you and you're really not moving, offensive foul. If you're shuffling your feet when he puts the shoulder in, they're going to call blocking on you. They are. But you should know by now how this goes. I'm not trying to hear you're playing all the way back and you're going to let that guy knock it down. That's crazy. That's what's been hurting us the most when it comes to defense. And Kobe gave us all this credit last night before the game. We're a good defensive team, a highly defensive team. We get turnovers, granted, but it's off of people's mistakes. It's really as simple. Turnovers are from offense mistakes. That's what it comes down to. Unless someone picks someone's pocket, then it's not a steal, all right, as far as I'm concerned. I know you're going to say that's wrong, but it doesn't matter, all right? If someone throws a lazy pass to a guy, a lazy bounce pass, and you pick that off, yes, technically it's a steal, but that's his fault for throwing that lazy bounce pass. You were just smart enough and fast enough to pick up on it. It's that simple, all right? Yes, that's good defense to an extent, but you have to understand real defense lies in locking a guy down. That's what it comes down to. When they're uncomfortable, when they don't feel like they're getting the ball, when they start getting mad, start yelling at teammates because they're not being fed the ball enough, a la Dwight Howard. Yeah, he gets locked down a lot, believe it or not. He's always crying about not, when they lose, he cries about not getting the ball enough. When they win, everything's okay, apparently. Alright, doesn't matter how many points he puts up, he still feels as though he's not getting the ball enough because he feels there's a mismatch when it's not a mismatch. Because I put it like this, and this happened on the street not too long ago. He's playing street ball, alright? If you have a mismatch and the guy's smaller than you and you're calling for the ball like this, alright? If another person on the offense comes around to you in a switch, guess what? He's drawing that defender with him to you, which could cause a double team. Then Dwight Howard is stuck. Unless he either gets fouled or he misses the shot completely and gets frustrated. You have to understand that these type of things happen. When someone calls for a mismatch, guess what? The rest of the team needs to step to the side and let him do his thing. And that goes for any player, all right? But that's not how it works, all right? These days, teams in the NBA, and there's a nice write-up, I believe, not too long ago that was on, on Twitter? I think CSN put it up about how ISO players are a rare breed these days. It's almost ISO playing is extinct these days, which I don't think it is. But they wrote an article about it, and it was really interesting because, like I said, there's people who just don't know basketball. There really is, all right? But you have to understand, guys, that this is going to become a problem. And if it becomes a problem in basketball, well, then you have to go look to play basketball, to get your entertainment somewhere else when it comes to basketball. Someone asked, JR asked not too long ago yesterday, he asked, now that football is over, what are you going to do on Sunday? And I said, that's just going to extend my time to go play basketball. I'm not going to sit in the house. Are you crazy? I'm sitting in the house. What? If there's a hockey game or something, well, maybe I'll sit in and watch it. But other than that, I'm going out, man. I'm going out to play because, like I said, I just don't, like I said, I'll put it like this. If all else fails when it comes to these videos, if the channel goes down, I'm just going to go back to being me. I'm going to go back to going to different neighborhoods and playing basketball and being me. All right? Because that's what I do, man. All right? I love it. All right? Like I said, you love the sports. Go out and play hockey. You go out and do this. You love the sports. You just don't sit in and watch them and think, oh, I'm a genius because you can sit here and do. No. You have to go out and get that experience yourself. It's about loving the game. It's not just about watching pro sports. So when I see all these guys talking pro sports all the time, and it's all they talk about is pro sports, I kind of question them. Because the pros isn't everything it seems. Why do you think you see so many pros go down back to the street level? Because they're looking for that competition, because they respect what's going on in street ball. They respect it. And when I mean street ball, I mean people who just play street ball, not that, oh, I'm going to dribble 1,000 times and then can't make a shot. That don't mean nothing. That's nothing. All right? We're talking basketball here. Like I said, for every pro that has made it, there are at least 1 million other guys who are just as good but weren't given the opportunity. You have to understand that. See, it... Whatever, man. Also, I see that, Lakers, like I said, the Lakers, they're not doing very well. I see the Bulls, like I said, the Bulls are hurt. The Heat, they lost to the Bucks, you guys tell me not too long ago. They didn't show it here on TV, all right? I see, the Oklahoma City Thunder? I gotta talk about this. One of you guys asked me who's the best player in the game today. I said it's a toss-up between Kobe and Kevin Durant. That's right, I'm going on record saying it. Kobe and Kevin Durant, due to the fact that Kevin Durant is balling, all right? He's had one game where he's had his all-time low when it came this season, all right? And he had 19 points that game. Kevin Durant is the truth. And I understand Oklahoma City, those guys is running, all right? And I understand a lot of credit goes to Dan Harden, but still, those guys are running. And I put like this. What I saw last year and what I see this year, I think it's if Zach Randolph can get healthy again, it's going to be Memphis, and it's going to be, Oklahoma City again in the finals, as far as I'm concerned. I am not worried about the Clippers. All right, because the Clippers have this problem. I don't know why people keep giving Blake Griffin this type of credit. I don't understand it. For those who don't know, Blake Griffin will not be in the slam dunk contest this year. He's not going to defend his crown because he said, you know, that's not all he does. Actually, that's all you do, Blake Griffin, because you can't shoot the ball to save your life. What else do you do? All right, you can't. Without your inside presence, you're nothing. I'm sorry, but you are. And then we see all the flopping that you do, and it's like, come on, guy. All right? So you guys asked me, should he have been in the starting lineup for, you know, the West when it comes to the All-Star game? I said if Zach Randolph was healthy, you know, he should have started. He's more versatile than Blake Griffin at this point. I mean, seriously. I mean, right now, it's just off of popularity. We know how these votes go. We do. Also, Allen Iverson update. Apparently, he got an offer for Pro League. He's not NBA, but Pro League. Where he could be making, $20,000 a month? AI wants to come back to the NBA, but nobody will pick him up. You don't treat a man who is, the second all-time scoring, especially when it comes to the playoffs. There's no one closer to Michael Jordan when it comes to averaging points than Allen Iverson. You don't treat this guy this way. Someone has to pick him up, All right? There are a lot of guards out there who don't know what the hell they're doing, and they do need some type of veteran leadership. Seriously. He doesn't have to be a point guard. He could be a shooting guard. Either or, you can put him in any space, and you can limit his time. You can even say, even though he's, now he says he'll come off the bench. He will come off the bench. So, guys, please. All right? Somebody in the NBA, take a gamble on this guy. Don't let him, like I said, you used him for everything he was worth because he sold a lot of jerseys for you. He sold a lot of tickets for you. He created a stigma for you that you didn't have in the NBA for a very long time. All right? He brought people to the games. He, all of a sudden, players were getting tattoos and carrying on. And like I said, everybody wanted to be Allen Iverson when he was in the game. I'm not trying to hear all of a sudden that we should just abandon that because Ron Artest jumped in the stands and beat up a couple people. All right, I'm not trying to hear that because you can dress them up, but they're still going to act the same way. We still see it to this day. And I'm telling you now, I saw what happened earlier this morning with Kevin Love, and he's suspended for 2 games for stepping on Scola's face. He didn't mean that. You can tell he didn't mean it, but whatever. The NBA, I put like this. You got a lot more problems than suspending 2 guys for accidentally stepping on someone when a guy falls down and he's trying to get around them. You got to be kidding me. He even posted an apology on his Twitter to Scola because he didn't mean it. Clearly, he did not mean it, but it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. NBA, you need to clean it up, all right? You're so worried about handing out fines and texts and all kinds of crap, but you don't take people for flopping. You don't. I'm done. I am done for the day. I will talk to y'all later. Y'all be safe. I'm out.